movies. It's home movies, baby. It's family. That's all it is.
All right, peace, shalom, Hotep, Islam, you know, Islam. So I'm here with the king,
Al,
I mean, two letters, Al, sounds like
Doc. Al, or Al.
So, you know, once again, as usual, I'm going to have to put the mantra out, because it's not legal advice. We do not want for legal advice. If you need legal advice, you can seek a competent counsel. Please be advised. Everything we get is for entertainment, educational, informational purposes only. So if you decide to use anything in this video or any other video, you do so at your own risk. It may or may not be effective due to your misuse or proper use of the information. So with that being said, you know, we down in the A. And what's the name of this part, L?
This is Olympic Park.
Yeah, we down, you know, we downtown, across from the CNN building. The Omni Center, you know, politicking with the brother Al. And you know, the brother came across some of my education, entertainment, you know, on, you know, YouTube. And so, exactly how did you come across my
education, brother? Oh, my brother, I came across you one time before, right? But because I was in a certain zone,
right,
I couldn't understand where he was coming from. But my brother actually told me to take another look at it,
right,
and when I took that second look, that was the understanding that I got right now.
Yeah. I mean, it's nothing but information. I'm in no way encouraging anyone to do this. Like, if someone, you know, take this step and no longer want to be a debtor, stop acting like a debtor, stop thinking like a debtor, because a lot of people trying to become creditors, but they still have the mindset of a debtor. Like, they think like debtors. Like, they think from like a negative aspect. And so when you go into any kind of public venue, or if you're dealing with some type of public official, they can see that and they're gonna treat you like a debtor. So you gotta stop thinking like a free indebted and start thinking like a creditor. You know what I mean? Because essentially debtors end up always paying some sort of fine or they get thrown in the box. Creditors are the one that's making the loans, making the deals, you know, closing the deals, and so on and so forth, and you know, like building a real estate or something like that, they're making some kind of wise investment, where the debtor is like, oh, I'm so stretched out. And part of the plot is that they keep people, you know, working 8, 10 to 12 hours. Some people work a double shift, like 16 hours, so you really don't have time to like really do proper research and absorb the information that's really out there. I mean, because the information is really hidden in plain sight. But then, once, you know, someone wants to become conscious like yourself, and they see, nah, there's something to this, and you start probing, but then someone comes along with that debtor mentality. Oh, man, that's stuff. That's fake, man. Leave that alone. What do you say about people like that, kid?
Peace, Islam. Been through it so many times before, brother be like, yo, that's BS. But let me ask you, my brother, how much have you looked into it to know if it's BS or not?
Right.
Oh, well, I looked into this far, or whatever it is, but they have not actually done the actual education to themselves to find out whether or not it is what it is. They normally go on about what somebody else is going to give them, or they go on about what something that they may have read was misinformation,
right,
but they're not going about what's called right knowledge.
That's right.
Right knowledge, but at the end of the day, they fall in let to the wayside to somebody else's authority and not their own authority by being their own sovereign. Because you have to really look into it. You have to do your own personal research. If you don't do your own research, then what you left with? You're subject to somebody else's interpretations or opinions. It's not about somebody else's
interpretation. Right.
You gotta grow on your own. You gotta grow in the knowledge. After that, like, yo, what you do? You point somebody in the right direction. What you say? All the time. Don't believe me? Check it out
for yourself.
Right. And once you go and you check it out, you do your own independent research. That's
right.
Number one.
That's right.
Even if I wasn't sitting there all day and looking what you gave, right?
Right.
That still don't do me no service. The service does me by finding somebody that's going to give me some counter information to what you're saying, and me weighing it out to see, well, this person's saying based off of fear and emotions, and this person's saying based off of facts and
knowledge. Right. Yeah. So, I mean, you know, you were saying something very interesting to me over the phone. You was like, you know, this kind of information needs to grow. But you know, there's certain people that live out there in the cartoon world, you know, these people that's walking around with costumes and people don't really comprehend, understand that it's really a cartoon world. And you know, I mean, you know it's a cartoon world because they all have on costumes. The black robe has on his black, you know, costume. The bailiff.
On patrol,
yeah.
The bailiff, sheriff.
Yeah, the bailiff has on his
even
costume.
Even the clerk.
Right, the clerk costume. The lawyer, attorney, he got on his costume, which is, you know, suit, tie, and all of that. So, and they used this method to, like, really indoctrinate fear into the minds of the masses of the people. Case in point, the black robe comes out of all black. And you know, people have actually been taught that black is symbolic to everything bad.
Black guys wear
bad luck. Yeah, you know, black magic, all that's all black. Bad guys wear black. So what does he come out in? He comes out in all black. And then some of them are set up higher than you and they're looking down on you. So, you know, psychologically, that's actually instilling fear into someone that actually goes in there that's daunted. So when, the first thing you gotta do when you go before these people, you gotta be totally undaunted. You gotta be totally fearless and know how to stand on your own strength.
So can I ask you, what does undaunted mean?
Well, it means someone that's gonna go in that has no fear. They're not intimidated by, well, that's the judge. You can't speak to the judge like that. You know, undaunted means that you're fearless. Like you're just going in with all of your emotions detached and you're using right knowledge. You're using right knowledge, well, he's saying this. I'm gonna give him a conditional acceptance. And one of the things that I always emphasize that is about offer and acceptance. People don't get that. You know what people wanna do? They wanna file documents, just put them on the record, but they don't understand why they're doing it. So the first time they get some sort of commercial presentment, oh, talk. Oh yeah, I need your coach. Did you study like that? Did you get a good book on contract law? Do you have a black law's dictionary? You know, have you been doing the proper research that you should be doing? And the answer is usually no. Well, this is why you don't overstand it. And because there's no way you're gonna be an effective creditor if you don't understand contract law. Because everything that we do, it's a contract and board. In some shape, form, or fashion, there's a contract and board. But going back to what you said, brother, you said that this information needs to be spreaded, you know, to many people, and we need to build some sort of alliance and build it up. Can you, like, you know, like, just go a little deeper on what exactly you was actually alluding to with that?
So, we had a conversation 2 days ago, wasn't it?
Right.
In that conversation, I was trying to cross through that. Of course, this is not something that everybody's going to get. Like, you got so many people out here right now, but not one of these individuals is going to say the claim that we're talking about.
Right.
There's one brother sitting on the side that overstands what we're talking about, and it's your little one.
Right.
But the number, we're going to do the math.
Keep it going.
Do the math on the number of how many people out here who are not really overstanding that, where's this going to go?
So, right.
You have an opportunity to, like I was saying to you on the phone, it's not about reaching everybody.
Right.
It's about reaching those certain individuals that's going to accept the information, do their own personal research, independent research, and grow from there. I could have taken your papers, right?
Right.
And I could have said, let me file my paperwork, like you were just saying, right? But at the end of the day, when I'm walking from a black robe, hey, ta-ta-da. Can you please come over here and tell me how I'm supposed to get this done properly? But if I know for myself how I'm supposed to apply the information, I'm supposed to communicate to these individuals, if I do that properly, I don't need your assistance.
Right.
What you've done was you helped me stand on my own 2 feet. And so how can I say I'm sovereign and I'm asking you for help?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? I mean, there's nothing wrong with asking somebody some assistance, but if I'm sovereign, I can't ask you help in my sovereignty. Ask you help for, hey, my tire, I need help to change my tire. That right. Got nothing to do with my sovereignty. You know what I'm saying? But yeah. So all I'm saying is, like, at the end of, yo, it's so many people that's looking for the information, that want the information, but they don't know how to get the information. What did I say to you a minute ago? It's like, it was a question I asked you, like, some people have certain questions. They're gonna hit a brick wall.
Right.
And they're gonna need help. But based on the way they ask me questions, it's going to show whether or not they qualify. They've done their own research to get to that level.
So, I mean, what do you think could be like one of the methods that's actually used to, you know, attract more, you know, brothers and sisters, you know, and then, you know, educate them and get them to go out and educate others. Because in my experience, brother, like a lot of people, case in point, now I'm going to show you how wicked a lot of our people are. There's a brother, I'll put his name out there. His name was Mark Baltimore. This guy's from, you know, North Carolina. So this dude, man, another cat that live in a cartoon world, you know what I mean? So, you know, trying to do funny stuff, like he's SpongeBob or something, you know what I mean? And what I mean by SpongeBob, he trying to absorb information from me, then act as if he received nothing. So, you know, I done this dude, you know, some, you know, I gave him some guidance about a month and a half ago. So, last Monday, I get, like, something from PayPal. This guy's trying to, like, reclaim, you know, $750, you know what I mean? So I'm like, what? So first the guy was like, information not as described. So I was like, okay, I got a disclaimer. Contact PayPal, no problem. They restored it. So a couple days later, the guy, you know, comes back with some more funny stuff. Now he goes from, like, the information was not as it was described. The next time he says, he didn't receive the information at all. Now it kind of shows you this man's level of intelligence. And you know what? You know what rubbed me the wrong way? This is supposed to be a conscious brother. Because he you know, prescribed to actually being a Moor, you know what I mean? And he was actually using a Moor's name, you know what I mean? So I'm like, yo, this is not cool. So I sent him an email. It's like, brother, why would you do something like this? You know, here I am putting my life on the line. I'm risking, you know, possibly getting locked up or anything.
Exactly.
Like, put my face all over, you know, the world pretty much. And you trying to screw me up? Someone that's trying to help you? So it's cats like that, man. It's germs that literally have to be uprooted. You know, you gotta be able to discern, like, who's really real or who's really trying to infiltrate the movement, because those are the same kind of clowns that they use to infiltrate leaders like Malcolm X.
For that energy?
Yeah. Dr. King and all of that. That's the same thing that they had to do. The enemy couldn't come in itself, so the enemy, like, whisper in his ear, you know, put them spirits on him, like, get this dude right here, we're gonna pay you off. The only thing we need is for you to bring Taza Doc down. We want Taza Doc to come down. Now, if they had, like, you know, some information on him, like he already done something wrong, it's going to be a good one. They will sell you out even easy.
Give him an out to sell you out.
Right.
So in reference to what you're saying, is like, go back to old proverb, which is, a drowning man will reach for a twig, then they'll keep him afloat.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So, at the end of the day, he thought... He had an expectation. He thought you was gonna send him something that was like, back in the day, what was it called? You had, the money was gold. You know what I'm talking about? The gold leaflet.
Yeah. I know what you're talking about.
I forgot, please, in time you understand. But it was, he thought he was receiving that, but he got what he perceived to be an IOU.
Right.
But in reality, it was more than an IOU.
Right.
But because he had put expectations on it, he thought it was going to be something else.
Right.
But because his own level of information, he didn't realize what he received because he didn't do his own personal research. So.
Keep going.
As I say, it's important to do your own research. If you don't do your research, you do yourself a disservice. I'm talking to my brother over here, right? We have to do our own personal research at the end of the day to support. You have to be able to support yourself. It's not a welfare system. Farewell to welfare and support yourself
right.
At the end of the day. So if you do your personal research, you'll support yourself and you do yourself a service, not a disservice. That's what I gotta say.
Check it. But check this out. Now, what really his problems didn't have anything to do with me, because he gets the paperwork, all of that. He fills everything out. I guess maybe he's done something incorrectly and he sends in his UCC-1 and they kicked it back. So now he try and blame me. Oh yeah, Tyler, I need some coaching.
They
so
gave him an offer.
Right, they gave him an offer. So yeah, he accepted it, he acquiesced on it. So then he called me for some coaching. I tell him, brother, this type of thing happens over the time. Remember, you've been watching some of the videos? So just do whatever it is that they're asking you to do and send it back. They're gonna put it on the record. So he shook the butt. They reject my documents again.
file on demand.
Right. I mean, but it's something that he was doing, brother, that was preventing them from accepting the documents. And I keep trying, what is it, brother, that they're asking you to do? Because, you know, these people that I get that come on and have these confessions about, yeah, I went through it, so easy, no problem. Those were the people that followed the instructions and done everything in accordance to how it was supposed to be done. But now you have some people, like, you know, there's some states that I just know that's actually giving people confrontations, like Washington State now and Texas. But I mean, you know, and I tell people, like, you know, your domicile's in Texas, but you may not want to try to file there, because I've had other people that told me when they try to file in Texas, they don't want to accept it. So file it somewhere else that accepting the filings. It's real simple. But they don't want to do it. They don't want the hard way.
Brother with his wife and him, he filed in New York.
Right.
She filed in Texas. Yeah, he's like, hey, file here. She's like, no, I'm going to file over here. Okay.
Right. I mean, got to learn. But I mean, don't blame me for that.
Yeah.
Don't blame me for that. You know what I mean? So, I mean, it's cats like that, man, that I got to get rid of that kind of vibration. That kind of negative energy, I don't need around me, man. And you watching this video, man, what you was doing is wicked. And you're dealing with some demons. You need to clean yourself up, man. You clean yourself up because you're trying to do destruction. You can never be a creditor, man, if you try and bring, you know, some kind of harm
acting
to your
as
fellow
a debtor.
Man. Right. You're thinking like a debtor.
Yeah.
Like, you know, trying to hustle someone to try and bring you a remedy, man. It's real hypocritical.
I don't even think that he understands the reality of what a creditor stance is and a debtor stance is. Because had he did, he would understand that, yo, he is totally in a debtor status.
Right.
How can I hold you responsible for anything? I filed my UCC, I can't hold you responsible. Right. But what I did show you was, yo, look at the little deception they're trying to do on this right here. When you file your UCC online in New York, they're going to do one thing. The 1B field was not there, and they don't accept the other field for your the bond number.
Right.
They say that we don't need that. I don't ask you what you need. I just ask you to file this.
Right.
What do you mean what you need?
Right.
So yeah, you go through all of that, but at the end of the day, it's what you want to do. How you going to respond to that? Are you going to act like a creditor? Or are you going to act like a debtor? Period.
Yeah. I mean the whole, you know, thing with that, like, when you're filing online, there's specific reasons that they came out with these online filings, because they can actually control what you can enter into the computer. So if I walk around for that, I go ahead and file it online the way that they want it, but I still send in my hard copy the way that I want it. You see what I'm saying? So now it's on the record.
All day.
So that's it right there, man. So I send them my hard copy the way that I want it. Okay, you want this online, you want to play like that, and we can play like that. But I'm still submitting this hard copy. So because you mail, you know, a packet in to that particular division, and then they accept it. If you ain't accepting this, what's wrong with it? What do
what
I need to
saying.
Do to fix
I feel
it?
What you were saying. You were saying something about how, matter of fact, that's the book. What is it called again?
Infliction of Commerce.
Infliction of Commerce.
Yeah.
Like, you was so excited. That, matter of fact, even the paper you sent me, you was like, yo, you were so excited, you wanted to get it done there. I felt the same way. I wanted to get it done as quick as possible. And then after I had, you know, I wanted to get it done, I'm like, yo, I started seeing little subtleties that they were trying to do. Of course, it's like even going to, what is it called, online payment. So that you don't no longer do the paper payment.
Right.
So they don't have to send you that.
Right.
What is it called again? Exactly.
Yeah.
So that eliminates that. So once you start becoming accepted to the electronic format, you don't have the paper payment, you can't do a remittance. Because you just gonna pay them some out of your account.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So, but after going through that, I'm like, you know what, I see it now. But it took me to actually get into it to see it. If I keep stepping on the outside and looking at it, I will never understand it. I have to become a part of it to play the part of the game to see it. You got spectators watching the soccer game, you got spectators watching the football game, you got spectators watching the basketball game. But they don't necessarily, they're not involved in the game, they're just still spectators. It's the part about becoming more, not a spectator, but a participant. And then you get to the point where you're not a participant, you're the authority in the situation. What is a judge? A judge is what? A referee. That's all he is. You have an official judge. That's all he does. He want to make sure that things, or supposedly, things are going down good between party A and party B, or between the state and the, what is that one called? The debtor, they call it. Not even a debtor. What is it called? Defendant. I'm not a defendant according to the Constitution. What am I? I'm assumed, or should I say presumed, innocent until proven guilty. So if I'm not a defendant, what am I? What is it called according to the Constitution? You're not a defendant, you're a what?
Well, yeah, I mean, you're respondent. You're responding to something. A respondent, you know what I mean? You respond that like like your mom didn't name you defendant, you know what I mean? So when you go into a court and they refer to you as a defendant, if you don't correct that, then hey, you're putting yourself in a debtor status, you know what I mean? So now you're gonna defend what they actually bring against you. No, I'm the respondent. I'm responding to this court, you know what I mean? And now here's my channel order.
Right.
My channel order has the legal effect of rejecting the original offer and putting a new offer in place. So now, once I file my counter offer, I become the plaintiff, and they become the defendant.
Right.
So now, if they don't respond with an answer, I can win by default,
right,
because they have an answer. You know what I mean? Or if they acquiesce or do nothing, I win by default. But you know what people do? When they don't answer, like so many people say, yo, Tyler's a dog. You know, they didn't respond. I put stuff on the record, there's no response. I said, what do? Nothing.
Okay, so I mean, right now.
So what can you respect from this?
Yeah.
You ain't do nothing. They didn't do anything because they know you're not gonna do it because you're behaving like a debtor. But if they thought that, well, when you drafted up your documents, say you know you had like 10 days to respond, and the reason you give them 10 days, you know, 2 days for the mail to get there, you know, 2 days for you know. Actually, 2 days, 3 days actually,
right,
for a transaction of a security interest.
And then three?
It takes 72 hours for a transaction of a security interest for it to become legal. Then three for the mail to get there, three for them to mail it back in a Sunday.
One
so
Sunday.
10 days.
Right.
So you give them 10 days. So, you know, if they don't respond in that 10 days, now they're in default. But you know what most people don't do, King? Is they don't say in their documents, you have 10 days to respond. If you don't respond in 10 days, you agree by your non-response. You know what I mean? So when you put something together like that, that's a contract. So if they don't respond, that's in your favor. So, I mean, when they don't respond, you know what people do? What do I do now? What you should do is you send them a notice of default. I gave you 10 days, so you haven't responded. Now, I'm sending you a notice of default. They can go ahead and laugh if they want it. So I send them the second notice of default. If they don't respond, yeah, I'm gonna set a court date and get a default judgment against them. That's what they do to us, man. It's the same thing that they do.
I was totally oblivious to that respect you just said right there.
Yeah.
It's all love. To even know that I sent out my paperwork to you, or my A for B, whatever you want to do, my bond, whatever it is, right? But at the end of the day, I sent that out. I didn't even know that I should send something and back that up. To give the notice to that, yo, that is what it is. And you make it stand in what? In fact. It stands in fact. It's on record. So
I mean, I keep, you know, trying to tell people this, man, that court actually takes place before you actually go into a physical venue, you know, that they refer to as a court. By who? The people that's going to win in court is who keeps the best record. That's who's going to win in court. Like, so, you know, if you go in court, you're looking at crumbling, well, I have it right here, my honor, I'm not filing this on such and such date, they didn't respond. Now, he's going to turn to them and say, what's your answer? Well, no, he sent you this, what's your response?
Yeah.
Because now you're putting them on the spot. The spot is on them. So, you know, justice has got to be served, or, hey, you're exposing a fraud.
Exactly.
So before he exposes the fraud, he's either going to dismiss it
case,
or he's going to reward it in your favor, man. And that's how, you know, people that's like doing these, you know, acceptable values, you know, every acceptable, this is what I don't get. It has worked for me every time. Like, I no longer have a need to do an acceptable value because I don't accumulate debt. If I can't, you know, take care of something like warfare, I don't get it. I don't need it. Now, I'm planning to get a house pretty soon, so that's a whole different story. So I might, you know, get a loan to do that, but I know how to handle that. You know, praise be the Most High. I know how to go through the paperwork and scratch out things that I don't agree with and initiate with and then give them back. This is my channel order because I don't agree with that. But I mean, what usually happens during, you know, when someone's going out to try and get a housing loan and all that, the pretend lender always tell you, oh, well, yeah, we don't want you to lose this loan, so this just basically says right. this, just sign here, they rush you through it.
Right.
Because you don't even really have to be knowledgeable in law. If you read some of that stuff, there's no way you're gonna really agree with it if you sit there and you read through the whole thing. And then, you know, they sign, and then they see something in there about, after 3 years, you're gonna get a balloon payment where your rent might jump up another $500.
Yeah, you know I mean, arm.
Yeah. So it's gonna jump up. Well, I didn't know this was in the. They don't care what you know. The contract is right here. It's in the contract.
So you're gonna get in the car.
Yeah, you're screwed.
You get in your car.
Right.
What they wanna do? Hey, look, sign right here, right?
Same thing.
We gonna submit this paperwork. We gonna accept your credit report, but also understanding that they're not providing you funds for your loan.
Right.
You provided your own self. They was just nothing but a conduit to access what? What are you accessing? I'm still trying my best to understand that.
So, I mean, what's your question now?
When you get a house loan, a car loan, they're accessing your bond.
Yeah.
They're using your signature.
Well, they're using your signature. Right.
To provide payment.
That's correct.
But yet. So you already got the money, so Wells Fargo, Bank of America, whoever these institutions are, they already get the money.
Right.
But they want you to pay them back twofold.
Yeah, two or three times. Because generally what happens is that after a few years, this pretend lender takes that account and he sells it to someone else. And they claim they drop out of existence. So then, they will foreclose on the people because they change things up, the payments may increase, and they can't afford it. Where someone loses their job, well, you miss your note, your mortgage. So now we're gonna foreclose on it. But give me a chance to get. No, you signed right here. You agreed to this.
90 days done.
Yeah, 90 days is done. So you know, then the person really don't know what to do, but they agreed to all of this. Now, one of the things that they should do is to tell them to produce the original note with my wet ink signature and fingerprints. And know what they usually do? They say we lost it. And so they go, because the courts, you know, for entertainment purposes, are in cahoots. So they go in to the black robe and say, well, here's a copy. But a copy is not the original.
Right.
But people don't dispute that. You know what I mean?
Why you authenticate your birth certificate going into authentication.
Right.
You're not dealing with copies. What do we do with that?
Right.
And if it is a copy, have it authenticated.
Right. No, but
of course they
check
can.
This out. Right. But when they, if someone takes a copy and say, let's say, I'm going to tell you why a lot of acceptable values don't work for people, because they will send in an original document, right? And the company will send back, well, here's your document returned, and so on and so forth. We do not accept this type of payment. So, you know, what they don't get is they sent them back a computerized copy of the original. They don't send the original back.
And no person takes responsibility for that. It's
right.
a computer generated, which right. is a default
right.
if it goes in the court saying, I didn't send that, that was computer generated
right.
did that.
But the one discrepancy that they're overlooking too is that a copy is not the original. So the reason they're not sending back the original is because they used that and they got paid. So they sent a copy back and the person accepted it when they should say, no, that resembles my document, but it's not the document I sent them. That does not have my wet ink signature. And they know that they can pull this off on the average Joe. So they're just like, hey, you know, what do I do now? No, you've been paid. Because if you define
tender.
Acceptance in black laws, if they keep it, then that's acceptance. And if they accepted it,
receipt of it itself is acceptance.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. If they accepted it, that forms a binding contract. And that's what's important to remember about acceptance, is that it forms a binding contract. So if they accept it, if they keep it, then they can pay it. That's in accordance with UCC 3.603B.
Right.
If a tender payment is sent to someone that's authorized, you know, and qualified to actually, you know, render that payment, and it's accepted, there's discharge.
And if
they don't accept it, there's discharge.
Yeah, I was about to say that. Even
right.
if they try to send it back to me,
still
the
discharge.
Fact that you received it is discharge.
That's
but now if they send it back to me, and I say, oh, well, maybe I made a mistake. I begin to start doing that whole discourse thing where I'm
putting
myself in
the sign. That's what they want.
Right.
That's what they want. So, I mean, if, you know, because what you really did is create a remittance.
Right.
So, you know, it has your signature, it has your account number.
Right.
Just like, I mean, same thing that the dollar bill had.
Right,
the
exactly.
dollar bill is a promissory note. It's a promise to, you know, pay the real money return in the circulation.
And each bill number, each dollar bill has its serial number.
Right, right.
Then we're going
absolutely.
Back to an account.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So, I mean, it's the same thing. I mean, so, you know, with that, man, unless you got a couple more questions,
yeah,
we can actually bring this to
a close. Yeah, I would love to ask you a question in reference
right.
to dealing with the difference between A for B and bond, accessing a bond. What is the difference?
No. That, so, when I do an acceptable value, I am accessing my bond. That's why when someone becomes a secure party creditor, they're essentially accepting that birth certificate bond for value. So when I'm sitting off the debt, that's the account number that I'm using. So they're tapping into that. So they can't tell me that it's not there. According to House Joint Resolution 192 and Public Law 7310, it says it right there. I can sit off public debts. And this is the other thing people need to keep in mind. The public is always on the front. The private is on the back. So the people that's out there using these social security numbers and they're using the front of the card, that's public. That's not your number. Like your account number is always on the back. So, and this is why when you're going to a lot of these courts and they're trying to A for B, the document on the front, the black robe will tell you that, hey, you're gonna be found in contempt because you defaced my document. So you can't deface it. You know, you
you're
supposed to flip it over.
Right, that's where you sign the whole thing on the back. But I remember going through your video and you was talking about how to do A4P. It was like, yo, you put the first, the routing number, the birth certificate number, the address. So I was really, because I remember listening to you about a brother was asking you about, he did a, not a remittance, but he did a remittance, but he did it, you said he did it in such a cunning way. He didn't do it like an A4P. He did something different.
I think I know what you're talking about. He was doing a promissory note.
Well, he did.
Because he wasn't a creditor. So
right.
I told him, like, since you're not a creditor, lawfully, you can't do an A for B. Because when you're doing an A for B, that's saying that you're exempt from levy. And when you're exempt from levy, essentially that's saying that you really don't have to pay taxes and all that because you've asked for an audit and you clarified to them, I'm not a federal employee. So I'm exempt from levy, and so on and so forth. So he tried to do a promissory note. So I was like, a promissory note is what debtors do, you know, because that's a promise to pay. So that's like me going and buy a car with promissory notes. I'm increasing the debt because this is a promise to pay when real money, yeah, it doesn't discharge the debt. It just increases it.
Balloons, that's what you're talking about, balloons.
Yeah. So, you know, that's basically what he's done. But I told him, for him, that might have been a good move because he's a debtor. You know what I mean? He was still kind of thinking like a debtor also. But I told him that creditors would actually use a bill of exchange. So it's kind of like, you know, a bill of exchange, you give me this, and I'm going to exchange it for this right here. Was a promissory note, it's like, well, I don't have nothing, so just take this right here,
right
and
now.
I'm gonna pay
right
for right now.
Right.
You know what I mean? But when I hit you with that bill of exchange, it's like, yeah, take this for my services. Or if you got like, say, you know, if you're a barber or whatever, and I got you to, you know, cut my hair or whatever. So if I have like an equal skill, like say you need like your computer or something with you, I repair your computer. You've been paid. It was an equal, you know, barter or whatever of exchange. That's kind of how like the bill of exchange is. But the promissory note, nah, take this. This is all I have right now. And it's supposed to work like that on the private side between you and I because we did not accumulate the debt. The public accumulated the debt and these corporations.
So let me ask you also, you're sending your paperwork to Puerto Rico to the Treasury, right? And I'm sending them bond payment. I'm putting them on notice actually, my bond. How does that affect me? Let's say I put, $1 million. How is that effective in the real, in the fictitious world? Not the real world, the real world is man, private. We're talking public. How does that Like, I know I'm still trying to get a better understanding of that. I do my own independent research. I'm always building with my brother. We always going back and forth, bouncing thoughts off. So I have not come to a real understanding where, when I'm doing on the front side, most people do APP, but on the back side, as a creditor, I know I'm doing bill of exchange. So how am I showing that that could be different from what this brother's doing on the front side? I mean, I know you did touch on it a little bit, but I'm sorry.
No. I mean, creditors do the A for B, but I mean, the A for B is essentially done with corporations and the people that created this debt, because you and I didn't create the debt. So I mean, bill of exchange, accepted for value, a creditor do those. You know, it's basically saying, hey, accepted for value, and so because you're the creditor. The creditor decides what he wants to do. You understand what I'm saying? Like, if I'm a creditor, I can decide whether I want to be a 14-year-old citizen or not. Right. Because, watch this. Because, like, if someone violated me in such a way, let's say I felt as if I was discriminated against, they fired me from a drawer and called me, yeah, I don't want this nigga working here anyways. So now, if I'm rational, I'm going to act from a civil vision and say, well, you violated my civil rights. Now I'm going to sue your company for thousands. But so from that particular aspect, it doesn't matter if I'm coming from a civil rules and procedures, because it's to my advantage. See, that's the advantage that a creditor has over a debtor. What is a debtor going to do? The only venue that he can take is civil rights. And what happens when that doesn't work? You know what I mean? He's out of options. But whereas a creditor, I'll go ahead, it's like you're floating. You can float around. You decide what, you know, coat you're going to put on for the day. I'm wearing this coat right now. I'm going to wear this hat. You know what I mean?
So, respecting that game, I'm going to take a little further. When I watched one of your videos before, and I was like,
hold on the camera.
You were saying, you was explaining how you went through your whole situation with Black Gold in 2011, right?
Yeah.
So then you were saying how you charged the Black Gold $3,500 gold or silver payable. You know what I'm saying? So, how does that work out on the back end? I know it's not like I can walk up to this guy and be like, yo, empty out your account. It's not going to happen that way. It's a process, I understand. But let's say I put a lien on his property. I know he can't sell that property. And if he do, I got to get my $70,000 out of the $140,000 getting paid between him and the seller, who he's selling the house to. So he's going to get $70,000, I'm going to get $70,000. So how does that work out in our world?
Well, you can never go after the beautiful piece of paper. You can't go after him as a black groom. You can't go after him as a police officer. You can't go after him as an attorney. You have to go after the private man. You have to go after Jack Smith. You have to go after John Doe, and so on and so forth. Because now you're bringing him down. Because if you go after the entity that he's hiding behind, these people hold bond you. So the bond's going to protect them. That's why they have bonds in place. When someone say, "Ah, what's your bond number?" They don't care. Because the bond is in place to protect them from lawsuits. So you're not gonna injure the man by doing that. But when you say, this is me, because they don't, if you notice, they don't like to give up a lot of these people's names, man. How come I can't find his oath? You have to go up there as a man. So you're not drafting up something against him. It's not gonna be against Black Gold so-and-so. It's gonna be against John Doe. John, you're going to take the stand as a man, you know what I mean? I mean, because there's a maxim of law that says all men are equal, you know what I mean? And this is how you got to reach it. Is it not true, my honor, that we're all equal under the law, you know what I mean? And you being a public servant right now, and in the capacity of a man, I have authority over you. When people go into a court, they'll say, this is my court. Why? Because they're running into admiralty courts, and they think they're gonna use like the common law, the constitutional laws. That's not gonna work in an admiralty court. I mean, when the Black Gold say this is my court, he literally means that. He's telling you right there.
Yeah.
But he's, nah, that can't be true.
I put it in perspective, I put it to an email before. It's like saying, I put on one of the posts, it's like, you can't use NBA rules in a soccer field. They don't match up. So yeah, if you're doing NBA and you come with soccer rules, I'm like, yo, get out of here. I'm talking to that crap. Right. Get out of here. You wasting my time.
Right. It's kind of like putting Floyd Mayweather, in the ring with John Jones.
Right.
John Jones is gonna take take care of him each time, man. I mean, it's just not gonna work out.
Yeah, and so you know what they do? They dumb the rules down to where if he was stepping like, you know, kind of McGregor and all, and, you know, they trying to set something different. They're trying to set a precedent, you know what I'm saying? Right. But let me ask you also, so in respect to what you've been doing, like, I can't speak to any brothers out there, sisters out there, yo, but I know from my own independent research, you're putting other facts out there.
Yeah, yeah, no doubt.
What is your, at the end of the day, I know you're doing the following, I know you're doing it. What do you see it going to? What are you trying to, I mean, you helping people out, right? You just come to help somebody, right? Not only that, just Monday, somebody hitting you up saying, yo, why didn't you touch me? You're gonna get that.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, what do you see
going?
What are you trying to do?
Well, yeah, yeah, what I'm trying to do, man, is collaborate with like-minded brothers, sisters. You know, I talk to a couple of cats, you know, brothers, and you know, maybe like, oh yeah, I got some land, you know, let's come together. And another brother like, I got some livestock and all of that. I'm like, yeah. So you know, right now, you know, there's someone down here in Atlanta that I was talking to yesterday about real estate. They was giving me the ends on, you know, how to like, you know, get some properties and flip them and come out, you know, just simply by, you know, getting an investor that I invested into the property. So I'm trying to get smart on that. So as far as me, man, I'm trying to like build like ability, like, you know, have our own land with, you know, people that's like really want to be sovereigns. And so it's kind of like, you know how Native Americans got reservations? We have our own spot, and you know, we want to come out and deal. You know, we'll deal with this society, but don't come on our land. We don't want this on our land. And so, if you want on our land, this don't apply to us. Just like this system of war don't apply to people that's actually on reservations. Same thing. Don't bother us over here. So I mean, that's where our people should be headed. You know, you got a lot of people talking about, yeah, I'm gonna leave the country, we need to get out of here. America's Babylon. Where you gonna go? Where you gonna go? The man is controlling the planet. Where you gonna go, man? It's gonna be the same way, no matter where.
And it's gonna be even worse, as my brother was saying. He went to Ghana two times, my brother went to Ghana, and he done with a country that's 60 years young. So that means that they're worse into it than people. We 400 some years later.
Right.
We've grown and we've educated. We with a different perspective of it now. So they don't see it the same. They like, yo, what are you talking about? I'm trying to be like you. Like, I'm not trying. I'm not even trying to be like me. Why are you trying to be like me? They don't even see it. You know what I'm saying? They still looking at the whole American dream and trying to be like the black man in America or the white man in America. But the reality, we trying to get free of it.
You know what I'm saying?
Let me also ask you another question. So when you, I was saying to your phone, when you get a land, you get land, right? And you have your family on that land, and you have an understanding with the environment around you, be it the sheriffs or the police department, whatever it is, who have the constant control. How do you see yourself enforcing it? How do you see yourself taking it from where, like right now, if we was to leave here, we drive off, we can get harassed by police. When you get your own property, and you get your sovereign, like how do you put that on record?
Well, I mean, so, the mistake that we make as a people is when we get land, property, we don't have the authority to title. So, we don't really own it the way that we think we do. Even if we get like a house, some people pay houses more, but they're still paying taxes because they don't have the authority to title. So, when we do that, we have to, you know, sit down and draft up. Well, I want the authority of title rules. I'm not paying taxes for this. You know, this is my land. And, you know, it's kind of like, you know, some states have like this statute that a man is the king of his castle. So if you come into a man's house, a man can shoot you down, man.
Right.
You know what I mean? You're trying to infiltrate that man. It's kind of like the stand your own ground rule, like states like Virginia. They don't have the stand your own ground law, but they have the man is king of his castle. So if you try and break into that man's home illegal, he could shoot you, but then he could walk. It's the same thing if they try and come to your land, and hey, you have authority out there, because remember, these police officers are nothing but armed security guards, you know? They're working for some sort of like organization or what have you. And so they stretch the authority. Remember, all authority actually essentially comes from we, the people. But what has happened is that these public servants that the people put in power to govern the people, you know, has actually become like a Frankenstein monster. Where now the people fear this thing that they created.
Right,
the people
right.
created government.
Who created government? To the creation.
Man created government.
Right.
So now you created something, but you're afraid of it. And what they tell these people behind closed doors, you go out there and you enforce the law. You get as many tickets. Now, how much you feel, man, if your primary draw is to get up and go out and screw someone's life up. Like, your primary purpose is to go out and write as many tickets as you can, you know, go out and arrest as many people as you can. You're making those people's lives miserable, but you're profiting off of that.
Right.
And it's all because of commerce. It all goes back to commerce. So your primary job is to sit back in the cut, you know, hide in a car out somewhere, try and catch me speeding.
Right.
You know what I mean? Try and catch me. I'm not injuring no one now.
Right.
Just because I need to get someone at a specific time, you catch me speeding and you write me a ticket. And that ticket, some people that write their whole lives,
yeah.
that might have affected their mortgage or their rent. So now they're in a dire situation and things just go downhill from there.
Right. So I take it to where exactly the same, like, yo, $60, $90, $100, $200, whatever the price is, definitely gonna affect somebody's home.
Right.
So at the end of the day, you are destroying somebody's life. And I'm continuously listening to the video. So there was one where the brother Brian, he was saying what other medium is it to where a person has to deal with meeting a quota. And so police officers have to meet quotas.
Oh, yeah.
So what other place have to meet quotas
is only
in sales.
Right.
So you continue selling.
That's what it is.
So at the end of the day, that's what it comes down to. They actually being pressured by, like somebody at CNN. We need more subscribers. We need to get out here and do this. Hit the pound of pavement. Get the papers out. Get up. But at the end of the day, you know what somebody got the law on that side, or legal, because it's not lawful, it's
legal.
The difference between legal and lawful.
Right.
So they have no people supporting them, because at the end of the day, most people are ignorant to the fact, they don't know that they have true law, true right to stand up, but they fall subject to statute, code, that's being given to them, so of course. So let me ask you this, when you're presented with an offer from a police officer, and you're a sovereign. I'm not talking about somebody who's in a capacity in SBC, Secure Party Creditor. Sovereign and Secure Party Creditor is not the same thing. You do understand, right?
Yeah.
So when you're in a sovereign capacity and you're being dealt with, because I do know that my brother and myself and other people, that's our move. We're moving forward towards that. Secure Party Creditor is just a stepping stone. We're trying to get higher than that. But we were definitely born by nature. We have to. He was given that right.
Yeah.
But now we just want to put it on record for them. That's all it is. It's all about putting it on record.
Yeah. Make a fucking record.
That's all it is. So that it ain't for me, because my father respects my sovereignty. It's like you respect my sovereignty,
right?
But he ain't. He like, yo, well, they told me I can do such. You know, how do you, and that's what I was trying to get across, it's going to be a point where you got to be able to, something's going to have to be put on record somewhere along the line about you being sovereign.
Yeah, I mean, so sovereignty is essentially having authority. It's kind of like almost impossible to truly be in the capacity of a sovereign without, again, having your own land, being on your own land and living within your own community. Because, I mean, you can easily exchange that word sovereign with king. So you're in control of, you know, everything within your environment. And you know, particular environment and also. I mean, so that's where the sovereign really is.
Right.
So if you don't have that, you know, land or what have you, then there's really nothing that could be done. You know what I mean? So they could come and go, well, we're doing here, so on and so forth.
Right.
Because, you know, you're on private property.
Right.
So you don't really can't do anything.
Right.
But when you're in the capacity of a sovereign, it's totally different.
Okay.
Understand what I'm saying?
Okay, absolutely.
Yeah. So I mean, whereas a Secure Party creditor, the reason he's a creditor is because he still wants to operate in commerce. This is someone that may still like want to operate, you know, in the system and so on and so forth. But when someone, again, it goes back to like Native Americans. Like Native Americans, they are on their own reservations. You know what I mean? So they're on their own land. So on their land, it's kind of like, it's almost like you're expatriating yourself and you're unalienable. Because when you're sovereign, you have unalienable rights. That means they can't place a lien on you. And so for instance, the reason they have a problem with a lot of Mexicans in the world is because they can't put a lien on you. You understand what I'm saying?
Hey, I'm gonna say this, yo. I overstood, so I thought I did, unalienable rights.
Yeah, but it's really unalienable. Right.
And I had to go back and look at the word, and I really began to understand. It's actually saying unalienable.
Right.
It's not saying unalienable. Right. It's unalienable.
You can't place a lien on. Right.
Right. So now it's like, I commend you on what you're doing. Please don't put no, like, yo, let these people do what they're doing. Let them hate, man. Like I told you, I love haters, man. They give me motivation. Yo, okay, so if I'm doing it wrong, show me what I'm doing wrong. And if you can't show me what I'm doing wrong, you just know enough to give me motivation. You make me want to propel myself even more forward.
Yeah, you could go ahead and close it out, brother.
Hey, but definitely, I appreciate my brother stepping through, see me out. Appreciate love, Atlanta. It's all love. And SPC, Scoop Party Creditor, what are you waiting for? Sovereignty is our next step. I am sovereign by nature. Secure Party Creditor on paper, which is the fictitious world, but definitely sovereign by nature.
Right.
With that being peace, my brother.
Right.